Hello, what's happening? This. What's this, you ask? Well, this is simply the best thing that happened since sliced bread. Or is it? Maybe, I don't know yet. The other way to put it, this is an ELEGOO Centauri Carbon Core XY FDM style 3D printer. Rose of the tongue, that one. I knew ELEGOO for their resin process printers alone, and that's why I always pushed them on the periphery of my interest. So I don't even know how this model came to my attention. I was half looking for a cheaper and less consumer rights unfriendly version of the Bamboo Labs P1S printer. For a long time I had my eye on the Sovol SV8 for the massive printing volume, if nothing else. But that's pricier, not cheaper, and had issues with the early units delivered. So, I don't know how I arrived here, but I ended up putting down 350 euros to pre-order this printer. The package arrived before the expected date, so I guess the only thing left to do is to unbox it and see if I struck gold or if I'm gonna make some lemonade coming forward. I still don't have a good way of unboxing a large box without showing too much of the mess in my loft, but we'll soldier on somehow. The non-carbon variant of this printer is 100 euros cheaper, and that puts it very dangerous into cheap bed-slinging printers territory. So I don't know why would you still buy one of those and pass on a Core XY this cheap. I also didn't saw this non-carbon version available in the EU page of the ELEGOO store at any point, so that may be a reasonable barrier. The printer came packaged very well, but I also live in a part of the world where delivery of packages is done face to face, so couriers playing basketball with parcels would get pitchforked. And as a consequence, unless the sender was really, really sloppy, I never in my life received an inexplicably damaged parcel. You need to be careful and remove all the packaging material inside the enclosure, including the one piece in the poop chute and the large box of accessories. You also need to release the printhead assembly that is cable tied to one side and finish up by removing the three screws on the bottom that lock the bed for transport. The accessory box contains a power cable, touchscreen, spool holder and a bag of miscellaneous. In the bag you can find a small amount of rapid PLA plus filament, a metal blade for the printable scraper that I'm never gonna print and use, and the necessary tools for complete disassembly, I assume, although only one hex key is actually required to complete the initial setup. Also there is what I am assuming to be lithium grease, a long unclogging needle for the nozzle, a replacement nozzle cleaner, and an 8GB generic USB drive containing manuals, software and a copy of the models that are already in the printer's internal memory. Let's generate some static then. The screen ribbon cable only has a single row of pins at the top. As long as you position the screen on the right way up, it goes right in, and the screen itself goes inside and down to lock it into the enclosure. The spool holder goes on the side, right under the filament sensor and button tube. Even more static, courtesy of the top glass panel. Plug the power cable in and we're off to the races. At first boot, there's a 20-minute initialization process. Any of these steps can be manually prompted at a future date if necessary. As my first step, I did what was intently asked of me and connected the printer to my Wi-Fi and proceeded to update the printer's firmware. I guess it's ready, so it's time to put some filament in. For now, I will use regular PLA because I have a lot of it, and I need to find ways to use it even with these fancy speedy printers. I also separately ordered and already received some of ELEGOO's own Rapid PLA Plus in both white and black variety, but that's for another time. I had to hit the retry button on the load filament page a couple of times until filament started shooting from the nozzle, but once it did, it quickly pushed out the red filament that was left in from the QA testing and replaced it with my white one. And it pooped a little from the back of the demonstration. Good boy, girl. Let's start printing with something simple, like a chap cube. ELEGOO slicer is just an Orca slicer, so it's very good. I went with defaults here, and for generic PLA the slicer put in 200 degrees Celsius, which I thought is a bit excessive. This time I went the old-fashioned way and copied the G-code on the included USB drive and carried it over to the printer. It's stupid easy to send the file from Orca / that ELEGOO slicer to the printer directly, as long as you connect it to the IP address of the printer. The printer's interface is also available on any device capable of launching an internet browser, so any old phone or tablet can be used to keep an eye on the print status remotely. And noisy too. First print went well, with the exception of the massive elephant foot at the bottom of the print. I blamed the too high of a temperature for this, so I tried to print on the B side of the plate and at 200 Celsius. Immediately apparent should have been the fact that the first layer is not up to my standard, but at the time I simply noted the improvements in quality and moved to a 3D printer mini test. This model was extremely hard to remove from the bed, even though it should be apparent that the first layer, again, is less than stellar, and it's not completely molded into the plate. Closer observation of the print, that was absolutely fine from the layer 2 upward, got me immediately worried because of the unevenness of the first layer. What is that about? Speed? Old PLA? I didn't immediately figure it, so it was time to fall back on some first layer testing. My test model for this is a simple rectangle that is big enough to catch problems, but not too big to take too much printing time. It also has two distinct halves, one with a single layer and the other with two layers. So let's go. I stayed on the B plate at 200 Celsius and the first print was bad. Not as bad as it was going to get, but bad nevertheless. Thinking the old PLA is not fluid enough at this speed, I bumped temps back to 210. The print was better but still unacceptable. I decided to repeat the test on the A side of the printing plate, starting back down at 200 Celsius. The resulting print was better than the print at the same temp on the B side, but still not good enough. The 210 Celsius on the A side was the best yet, but had enough artifacts, especially on the single layer half, that instead of alleviating doubts, it warranted further testing. It looked like more temperature equals better, so I figured what if I go with the higher temps and also reduce the speed. It can't hurt it, right? Now comes the kicker. All these prints are done at balanced speed, which is a global printer settings that means it obeys G-code speeds at 100% of their value. There are a couple of irrelevant options to increase the speed, and a single silent option that halves it. The problem is, you can't set this global setting as global before the print, You need to change it as the print runs and it takes effect only for that particular print. And I'm talking about the actual print, not the prep phase, that can take anywhere from very little time to 20-30 minutes if it includes bed leveling and significant drops in temperatures between prep and actual printing. How come? Because the bed cools very slowly, you can have 40 minutes actual printing time for a 10-minute print. To add insult to injury, once the print has started, I could never do any remote change from the web interface, not even operating the integrated light. At that point, I could only pause or cancel the print. So what this means is that to change the speed, you need to be physically present at the printer and catch the moment the printing starts. In my case, I decided it's easier to fumble in the slicer with the advanced settings and halve the speed of the first layer, so I did just that. But once the print started, I also had to stop it because the result was the worst one yet. And I mean horrifically bad. What the hell is even that? How could lower speed be such a destructive factor? I immediately thought about pressure advance. I even printed the relevant test to find a good value for this filament. But even as this printed, I thought, wait a minute, let's get back to that monstrosity. I know what this is. I have the scars to prove it. This is the original detachable plate from my beloved Ender 3 Pro. This is what the printer came with and it was absolute garbage. It took me a lot of tests to realize it's not the aluminium bed that's crooked, but this detachable plate had a big hump straight in the middle. That meant if I printed a small thing in the center, I had to either print elsewhere but in the center, or set the nozzle height to be correct only in the center. If I had a large print, I had to set the correct height at the leveling screws, fully knowing the first layer will suffer in the center when the nozzle scraped over the hump. In extreme cases, it could look like that. So I immediately turned my attention to the spring steel plate and boy was it warped. And by this point it was visible to the naked eye. No more than 10 heat cycles were enough to warp this plate horribly. To confirm, I printed an almost full plate single layer print on both sides and the results were eye-watering. The A side revealed the plate is very wavy on the left and bowed on the right. Bed leveling can fix the bowing, but the waviness is too high a frequency to probably even register properly. Switching to the B side confirmed the issue, with the bow waviness sides switching but also the highs becoming lows and vice versa. This plate is trash and I am stuck. Now, I've contacted ELEGOO support and they were quick to send me a replacement plate. I also bought an aftermarket one because of course I'm gonna buy a golden colored one. Are you kidding me? But they are both traveling from the Far East and this is my story as it's unfolding. So it will take a minute for this saga to conclude. For now this will end in something of a cliffhanger. Will this printer end up being good? Meh! Or is it garbage? Stick around and find out.